is Carol Wanjao. I'm a pastor and I'm also a marriage and family therapist. And in this video, I want to ask or to answer the question of why. Why is it that some families have been severely hit by COVID and others not as much? And even more importantly, what should families in distress do to alleviate their stress levels? Now, as pastors and counselors, we have been receiving numerous calls and texts from various people, some that have been very worrisome, to be frank. And what I'd like to do is I want to read for you a couple of them so that you too can benefit from the answer that I will give in this video series. And I'll read the first one. And here's what it says. Dear pastor, I really do not know what to do. Life at home has become unbearable. Whereas before I could come home late, now I am at home the whole time with my quarrelsome wife. She's so quarrelsome. She starts in the morning and continues into the night. As for the children, they are so unruly. The house feels more like a battleground than a place of refuge. No wonder I enjoyed staying away from home. And that's from someone called JB. Ouch, JB. I feel you. I mean, that is a crazy making situation to have just a quarrelsome spouse with you all day long. Then the second one is from someone who just signed off as NM, and it says, Dear Pastor, whereas before I was afraid of contracting a venereal disease, I am now in addition afraid of contracting COVID. My husband has not stopped seeing his women, and with the curfew, he's now spending many more nights away from us. What should I do? What should I do? And again, NM, I feel you. I mean, they are just having to deal. Am I dealing with a venereal disease or am I dealing with COVID? That can be a very stressful time. And I want to begin by saying that for those of you who are experiencing heightened conflict or discomfort during this time, you are not alone. You know, just a couple of weeks ago, a survey done by InfoTrack indicated that 75% of Kenyans were experiencing anxiety over the COVID situation and they were really unsure about the future. Now, as pastors and counselors, we have long come to the conclusion that not all that glitters is gold. Many families are in distress, but you cannot tell by the way people dress, you cannot tell by the place they work, the cars they drive, or even the pictures that they post on their social media about their families. So do not be fooled into thinking you're alone. You are not alone. However, we can do something. We can do something to make life better. And this is what this video, you know, series is all about. What can we do at this particular time to alleviate the stress that we're going through? But to do this, I want us to take a long, hard, and honest look at our marriages. I want us to do that. Now, having been married for 26 years, I know, I have also come to understand that whenever we go through issues with my husband, it normally has to do with foundational issues that we have not dealt with. And if we can be frank, even in this conversation, and I hope that we can be frank, what COVID is exposing, even for myself, you know, as a married person, are that the fault lines that already exist in the foundation of our marriages. Now, being together in the same house or having to come home early, or even maybe loss of income, which is an added stressor, has just compounded issues that were already existing in our marriages. It has just compounded them, and now we're just finding ourselves very uncomfortable. And this is a conversation I want us to have today. You see, foundations are very important. You can put up a very beautiful building based on appearances, but as long as there are fault lines in the foundation, that building has an inherent weakness. In fact, foundations are so important that Jesus in Matthew 7, 24 to 27, talked about them, and he talked about them in the parable that he called the wise and the foolish builders. And this parable to me is so profound that I'd like for us to read it and to kind of remind ourselves, for those who may be familiar with it, to remind of ourselves what it says, because I think it's so, so important. Verse 24, therefore, if everyone hears these words of mine and puts them into practice, it's like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, yet it did not fall, because it had a foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on the sand, and the rain came down, and the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash. Now, in the same way, the way that we are experiencing COVID is a very clear indicator of the type of foundation that our marriages are currently resting on. A strong foundation will predict a strong and steady relationship that is able to face this weather, this storm, and any other storms, whereas a weakened foundation will produce a marriage that will be shaken by various crises, including COVID. So where are you right now? Where are you? You know, we had said that we want to be frank and to look at our marriages and to evaluate them. So where are you right now? Are you thriving as a family? Are you experiencing COVID, you know, like a minor inconvenience? Have you been affected moderately where you're making some lifestyle adjustments? Or has it completely thrown you off and you're feeling so, so disoriented? So evaluate honestly and see where you are as a family. Now, when we talk about a building, it normally has one foundation that is put up by a builder or an architect. I mean, it's one person who's thinking through, you know, how this building is going to be. But in marriage, things are a little bit different. Because in marriage, you actually have two builders who then come together and they lay a common foundation. Now, this can be very tricky because, unlike the solo builder who makes all the decisions, in marriage, the quality of the foundations that we put together will be determined by three factors. And I want us to listen very carefully to these three factors just to see again where we are. Now, the first is the ability of the builders to agree. The more the builders can communicate or relate well together, the better they will be able to build together. I mean, I remember a few years ago, we moved, you know, into a new house, and we were trying to decide the paint. I mean, it was that basic, the paint of the house. And it was so difficult for the two of us. We could not agree on the paint. And you can imagine, by the time that we were done selecting our colors, my goodness, that house just looks like something else. And so that's why I'm saying the better you're able, you know, to agree together or to relate together, the better the foundation is going to be. And relating together is simply how well are you considerate of one another? How kind are you to one another? How much do you respect one another? How much do you listen to each other's views? Philippians 2:3, chapter 2, verse 3-4, I just find so amazing because it says, and I'm going to paraphrase it apply it to our situations. And here's what it says. It says, don't act out of selfish ambition or be conceited. Instead, humbly think of your spouse as being better than yourself. Don't be concerned about your own interests, but also be concerned about the interests of your spouse. Amazing verse, isn't it? Now, again, I want you to rate yourself. How well do you take into consideration your spouse's point of view? How well do you do that? So that was the first thing, you know, that determines the quality of a foundation is the ability of the builders to agree. The second is the commonality of our values. You know, the more values you have in common, the easier it will be to build together. And here we're looking at blueprints, you know. Do you have common values of parenting? Have you sat and agreed that these are the values you shall use to raise your children together? How about matters in-laws? Do you have a common approach of dealing with your parents? Have you agreed on that? How about money matters? Do you know what each of you earn? You know, have you kind of just share, this is what I am, this is what I bring. Have you agreed on how to manage your finances together? Again, rate yourself. Rate yourself and see in which areas is there common agreement. Is it in parenting? Is it in in-laws? Is it in investments? Or is it even the home budget? evaluate yourself. Celebrate the ones that at least you have a common understanding about. Now, the third thing are family backgrounds of the couple. When couples come from healthy family backgrounds that support healthy marriages, then they already have within them, they have a relational DNA of what a good marriage looks like. But if, say, one of you or both of you come from a very difficult background where, say, there was violence or there was divorce, then it means that such a couple will have to be even more deliberate in the way that they go about building their marriage. Now, this is not to say that it is not doable. There are so many couples who have built successful marriages, having come from very difficult and estranged families, backgrounds. But you know what? With God's help, anything is possible. And so again, I want you to rate yourself. Be honest and ask, does your family background support marriages? Does it? Do your parents, do your siblings, does your marriage background support marriages? Now, all these factors, all these three factors that I have mentioned will determine how you're currently experiencing COVID. The more you're able to agree, the better your outcomes. Now, I can hear some of you say, you know what, Pastor Carol, you know, what you have shared is fine, you know, that's okay. But my problems right now are so urgent and I am in need of some urgent solutions. And you know what, you're right. You are right. Repairing foundations cannot be done in one short video. And so what I want to do today is I want to give you a tool that will help you manage your current crisis. Because I do know that we're facing just a situation that is really bringing a lot of anxiety and a lot of stress. Some of you may have come across this book. It's a book by Steve Covey. It was a famous book. And he wrote this book a few years ago called 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. And what he was doing, he was looking at people who are effective. He was looking at leaders and asking, you know, what is it that makes these people effective? And so in that book, just the first couple of chapters, he talks about a concept called circle of concern versus our circle of influence. Now, our circle of concern are the things that are happening around us that we are deeply concerned about, but which, you know, we feel powerless to change. You know, for example, from the scenarios that I had shared earlier on, you know, the letters that, you know, we are receiving as pastors, it could be that you have a drunk spouse. It could be, you know, you have a wayward child, or you have truly uncontrollable children, or it could be an irresponsible and a possibly philandering spouse. Maybe these are the situations that you're facing, and they're making you bitter, they're making you angry, they're making you frustrated, resentful, because despite your best attempts, you have been powerless to change that situation. You've been powerless to change your spouse, and you've been powerless to even change your children. Now, what Steve Covey says in that book is that you cannot change them. You cannot change them. But what you can definitely influence is the situation. You can influence the situation around these circumstances, and you do that so that you can bring your own levels of stress down. So I want us to get practical. Right now, I'm thinking of a situation where your spouse has lost their job, and because you're not even on talking terms, they're not sure when the rent was last paid, and this has been frustrating you to no end, and it has been the cause of many quarrels. What should you do? And especially because your spouse was the one responsible to pay rent. So if we are to apply the concept of, you know, the circle of concern and the circle of influence, remember what I had said, the circle of concern is what you cannot control. Okay, so you cannot control the fact that your spouse is no longer working. You cannot control that they have not paid rent. You can't control that for the last few months. You also cannot control the decisions they are making, because remember, they are adults. They are adults. You might not like what they are doing, but nagging, quarreling, violence, and shouting will not change them. It has not changed them in the past. It's not about to change them going forward. We do not have the power. Here's the annoying thing. We do not have the power to change on anybody. Only God does. But if you can bring yourself in this whole mess to see your spouse differently, you know? If you can understand, if you can see them as a broken individual with a broken foundation, indeed making foolish decisions and desperately in need of God, then perhaps this perfect perspective will, you know, take you a long way in helping you lower your stress level. So maybe a change of perspective. However, there's something that I believe that you can do. I believe there's something that you can do. And this is what we call our circle of influence. You know, just the things, what is it that you can influence? What is it that you have influence over? Now, for example, maybe you can approach the landlord and negotiate with them a payment plan. Maybe you can do that. And guess what this does? This is an immediate intervention. And when you do that, and you know, the landlord is agreeable, it will definitely reduce your stress levels. Now, I know this does not answer the question of your spouse being irresponsible. In fact, you're probably very irritated about that idea. But I want to give you a perspective. I do. And listen to me. Just stay with me for a little while. Your spouse not paying rent or being responsible actually points to a bigger issue. It points to a larger issue, and that is the issue of a broken foundation. That is what it's pointing to, that your spouse has a broken foundation. But guess what? Not just your spouse, but also you have a broken foundation. Because like it or not, we all marry at our level of maturity. I mean, ouch! You know, when I first heard this, I didn't like it. I really didn't like it. I didn't like the fact that I have married at the level, you know, my husband and I are at the same level of maturity. Because you see, I always used to blame my husband for all the issues that we were going through. And in fact, it really felt good. I must confess, it really, really felt good. But I remember one of our counselors telling us that the reason why we marry at our level of maturity is because if we deem somebody else less mature than ourselves, then we will not be attracted to them. Reason being, we're going to find them juvenile. You know, they're going to be too childish for us. And so we will not be attracted to someone with a less maturity. Conversely, if we find someone who is more mature than us, then we will not find them attractive either because we're going to be intimidated by them. And so this is how we find ourselves marrying at our level of maturity. And so at this time of crisis, what should we do at this time of crisis? And I want to read Proverbs 27 verse 12. And this is what it says. Sensible people see trouble coming and avoid it. But an unthinking person will walk right into it and regret it later. What this proverb is telling us is do whatever it takes to avert the immediate crisis in your family. Do you need to move to a cheaper housing? What assets do you need to sell to pay off your debts? What expenses do you need to cut back? Who can you call to seek for counsel? Now, I know these are tough decisions that need to be made, but then again, you're making them for the sake of reducing your own stress level. Now, I had said earlier that repairing foundations takes a while. It really does. And this COVID situation has only revealed what is already there. But the hopeful thing is that foundations can be repaired. In fact, it takes a crisis to reveal the urgency of the matter. In a sense, we can say that COVID, you know, it has exposed our foundations. And again, it tells us just how urgent we need to, you know, deal with our foundational issues. So I can see that this is a time that God wants to bring healing and restoration in our marriages. So as I conclude, here are a few things that you can do to begin to mend your foundation. And I must say, this is for you. This is for you. In fact, your spouse might not be interested in repairing their foundation. And again, you can't repair theirs. That's why I'm saying this is for you. But guess what will happen? As you grow and as you repair your own foundation, your spouse will have no choice but also to grow. Now, if both of you are ready and you're available and you're even watching this video together, and you're able to do this exercise together, then fantastic, praise be to God. But if it is only you who is available at this time, you can make a difference. You really can. And so I just want to share with you some two things. The first is surrender to God. Surrender your issues to God. God is our creator and he's able to help you. Matthew 11:28, here's what God says. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. I will give you rest. And it's like God knew that, you know, we do have many burdens in our lives. And he knew that, and he knows that, and he's inviting us to come and lay those burdens before him, because he will give us rest. And this begins by acknowledging to God that you need him. You do need him. Your situations are difficult. Acknowledge to him that you need him. Surrender your spouse to God. Surrender them. Ask God to deal with them, because he's well able. Perhaps you're listening to this presentation or this video, and you too are struggling with addiction. And because of your addictions, you're struggling to fulfill your family obligations. Or perhaps you're struggling with anger issues. You're struggling with being jobless or with fear and anxiety. It also might be that just because of COVID, the weight of decisions that you have to make is so heavy on you, and you're feeling overwhelmed. And what this verse is telling us in Matthew 11:28 is, surrender this to God and invite him. And you will be surprised at what God is able to do when you invite him into your situation. So pray. If you can even fast, fast. We as a family pray and fast, at least, you know, and the other situations that are going on around us. So if you've never fasted, fast, and you will see the hand of God moving in your family. The second thing is prayerfully take control of the issues that are operating in your circle of concern. You know, move those things from your circle of concern and just see, what is it that I can influence? These things that are irritating me, what can I do to influence that situation so that, you know, I'm influencing it rather than it stressing me? So choose to do the right thing. Proverbs 25:28 says, he who has no rule over his spirit is like a city that is broken down without walls. Do not be ruled by your body impulses. Do not be ruled by your anger. Do not be ruled by nagging or violence. Do not be ruled by those things. Rather take control. You know, have a schedule and a structure of the time that you get up and sleep. Even if you're jobless, put in order that schedule. Think through the things that you have not given attention to, to busy work schedules and so on, and do them during this time. This is also a good time to think through your skills, your talents and passions, and see if this is not the time to start something, you know, a small hustle from which you can earn some income. What I'm trying to say is that there is something that you can do. There's something that can be done to move you from those things that are concerning you so much. You can influence them to do something that is positive, that will reduce your stress levels. Now, being proactive, which is what I have been describing, rather than being reactive, is one of the ways that we grow in our maturity. And it is also one of the ways that we begin to mend our foundations. Being proactive is the way that we reduce our stress, and it is the way that we begin to improve our relationships significantly. Now, I'd like us to pray. Before I pray, I want to say, if you'd like to be part of the Mavuno community and to receive prayer and support, you know, from our pastors, or if you have questions about even some of the things that I have been talking about, you know, you can click on the link below to join, you know, our Mavuno WhatsApp community. Indicate that you would like prayer. And also say the area that you live, so that a pastor near there or near you can call you. Also, if you have found this content helpful, you know, you can share it with a friend who might be in need. And you can also remind them when the next video comes out. And again, if you have any questions, direct them to the WhatsApp number, and I will include them in my next video. So I'd like us to pray. As we pray, I came across this little book that is a very interesting book. It's actually a devotional, and it's called The Negativity Fast. It's a very interesting book. The author wrote this book at a time when she got so tired of all the negativity that was going on around her. And by the way, it was before Corona happened. And she thought of being proactive and writing a devotional for people going through a discouraging time. And one of the things that she says there, which I found so helpful, was that if someone is going through a difficult time, if you're going through a difficult time, invite Jesus in and expect great miracles. And I thought that this was such a great perspective, because when it is darkest, that is when the light shines the brightest. And so I'd like us to pray. It's okay. I want us to pray. I want to pray for you. And so I just invite us to close our eyes so that we can pray together. Father, we thank you for this time that we have had. Thank you for the opportunity to just talk. Just find out how we're doing in our marriages. For this time of even evaluating and seeing where we are. Understanding our foundations, even understanding some of the things that we can do to alleviate our stress levels at this time. I thank you, Father, that all knowledge comes from you, and I give you the glory and the honor, for wisdom and knowledge are yours. And I thank you, Father, that we are able to even share these things to help one another. I want to pray for someone who may be feeling right now that like they're in Egypt, being plagued, being harassed by many plagues, one after the other. Could be joblessness, it could be brokenness, it could be conflict, worry, anxiety, brokenness, you know, so many things happening. And Lord, at this particular time, I want to surrender these issues, just these presenting issues for everybody who is listening. I want to present these issues to you and invite you into these situations. Father, even as we think, we know that you're powerful and that you're able. You're able to help us. Thank you, Father, for your word that tells us to come to you when we are weary and heavily burdened, and that you will give us rest. And what I want to say is that I thank you that your word, that you are faithful. And I pray that as people indeed unburden themselves to you, that they will write and say that indeed you have given them rest. So Father, we thank you and we bless you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, Amen. So until next time.